Okay, my name is Martin Laforest, Manager of Scientific Outreach at the Institute of Waterloo, Director of USEQIP, and in a past life, that was not so long ago actually, only a year ago, I was a full-time researcher. Did my PhD here, I think we all know that by now, did my PhD with a real flam in NMR, both theory and experimental, and went flipped completely to the experimental side for my postdoc, and I didn't know what was waiting for me, but I loved it, it was great. All the work I'll be talking about here is not necessarily the work that I did, but it's what I was working with in Netherlands, which was spin and quantum dots. Netherlands in the group of Leeuwenweerde-Sijpen, Technical University of Delft, or Delft Technical University, or University Technical of Delft. One of those permutations. Fantastic university, by the way. So let me start first by explaining what is a quantum dot. What is a quantum dot? Anybody knows?
Ravi? Zero-dimensional system.
Huh?
Zero-dimensional system.
Exactly. So quantum dot is a very generic name. It just means that you have a system with zero dimension. It's a confined system. It's really something in a box. Okay. In the literature, or if you follow like the tech literature out there, or the tech blog sphere, you might heard about using quantum dots as No doubt that they're thinking about making trackpads on computer using quantum dots, or using quantum dot as single photon source, or using quantum dots to build laser, and so on. So those are what I call optical quantum dots. So that means we use the optical transition, so transition in the terahertz that you use a laser to control, and then you create an electron pair. That's not what I'm going to talk about today. Today I'm going to talk about what we call laterally gated electrical quantum dots. So we literally just, the only thing, all those fancy words just means that we're going to trap a single electron somewhere and we're going to play with it. There's many ways of doing this. And I'm going to talk about the one way, and the way that I know, is what we call two-dimensional electron gas technique. So first of all, you need to start, well, everything is in three dimension, at least at the level we're working at. Let's not bring in the 20 other dimensions that string theorists talk about. So we work in three dimensions, so we need to find a way to confine it to zero. So one of the first ways, we're going to use semiconductors. And we're going to use a heterostructure of semiconductors. And I'm not going to go into the theory of semiconductors and everything, because first, I don't really get it myself. And second, it's beside the point of what I want to talk about. So let's use gallium arsenide. Gallium arsenide is an semiconductor that we've been studying forever. Some of them, actually probably most of you already has one in their pocket, in their cell phone, and they can do good transistor, and so on, but we're not going to use that for that reason. Surface theory is actually a huge field of research. What's going on at surface of things? Because you have the discontinuity, lots of cool stuff happen, and especially and a surface, it just means when you go from one material to the next. So people have been growing, using molecular epitaxy, been growing heterostructure that looks like this. They grow gallium arsenide that has a certain crystalline structure. They can grow really pure. And then they start growing aluminum gallium arsenide in it. So it's just gallium arsenide, and they toss in a little bit of aluminum at a certain rate or a certain concentration. And then forget about the two-top layer for now. What happened is when you look at the bend structure of that material. Bend structure is, if you do any solid state at any point, you'll do that. So electrons are fermion, spin 1/2. Remember, fermion, it means that they cannot occupy the same state. So if you take a box and you fill it with electrons, they're always going to start occupying a higher and higher and higher and higher energy state. Right? So when you look at metals or anything periodic, you can find what we call the Fermi level. So essentially, if you keep on adding electron, the Fermi level is sort of, on average, at zero temperature, where's the last electron? Where's the energy? And if you go from one material to the next, then you have bend structure, so it starts moving around and things like this, but I'm not too comfortable with that, but let's leave it at that. If you study the bend structure of, let's say, gallium arsenide going to the aluminum arsenide, what you find out, so if we call it, let's call that Zen. Actually, that's the other way around. Z direction. I don't know if it's the 1-1-1, the 1-0-1, it depends on the crystalline axis. But here I'm really, like, I'm looking at the growth axis. So you have gallium arsenide. And then this, it depends on the growth, but what I'm going to show is really independent on if the crystal is like this or like that. It really just matter what happened at the surface, okay? So if you look at that, and it's probably not going to be precise, but if you look at the energy of the bend structure, it's going to look something like here, that's in the aluminum gallium arsenide. And then it's going to look like that at the gallium arsenide. Which it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to put an axis, but it can go something like that. And here's the gallium arsenide. And you can, you know, this, I'm not too sure why the reason is, but the Fermi level of those things come right here. Okay, when you start looking at the whole system. So what I'm saying here is, you see, you have a very, very sharp potential well. And because nature likes to be in low energy state, all the electron will just fall into that potential well. Okay? Well, of course, no, that potential well is very, so actually that amount of energy is not that big. So that's why we need to go at very cold temperature. So typically, at least under 4 Kelvin for that to happen. But this is a two-dimensional electron gas. Essentially, all the electron will get trapped at the surface. And the reason why we call it two-dimensional electron gas is because this thing is about 30 nanometers thick, really behave, like you cannot really measure the up and down movement. It's really a sheet to a very good approximation. So just by using a heterostructure, we're able to trap electrons in two dimensions. But now, where are those electrons coming from? The reason why we have this level here. Who doesn't know what doping means? Okay. When you dope a material or a crystal like this, it just means that you literally just dope it with another type of material with different valence band. Example here, gallium arsenide is in the, if you look at the periodic table, is a 3 and 5 element. If you dope it with silicon, which I think is either a 4 or 6, I think it's a 4. So they have different valence. So when you put them in the crystal, there's an electron who doesn't know where to go. So you have, so essentially you transform a semiconductor that doesn't conduct because we're still in the valence band, and then you give it some free electron. Okay? So then when you cool it down, those free electrons has to go somewhere. So that's why they come and populate that potential well there. Okay? Is that heterostructure part clear enough? All right. So, and there's an extra layer of gallium arsenide, but this is purely on the material science point of view. Some people use it, some people don't. Let's not worry about it. Okay. Now we want to confine into two extra dimensions. We want to confine it. We want to get rid of one dimension and another one. That's where those guys. This is my only slide, by the way. After that, it's all blackboard. That's where we construct those guys here. The construct is not really good. But now, okay, we have the z direction, we have your heterostructure. So now take the whole. Actually, that works perfect. Right? So you have aluminum, gallium arsenide here. Now start looking from the top. Okay, we look like this. On top of this, these are electrodes. We just pattern them in the clean room. We go in the clean room, we design a CAD program, put that in the electron beam lithography, and those are normally done in titanium gold or titanium sapphire. And those electrodes are connected to voltage source, DC voltage source, where we can just apply DC voltage as we want. Okay. So I can draw some gates on the top here, and you can have some fun. If you apply a negative voltage, what's going to happen? Keith?
The electrons will essentially be repelled away from the electrodes on the 2D surface.
Right. And if you apply a positive, you will attract them. Now, essentially, now here you have to pay attention. Why? Let me do that. So the electrons are here. The electrodes are somewhere on there. So if you put too much of a positive, then the electron can kind of jump, and then you start creating current, and then you fry your sample and whatever. But what I'm saying, Here is if you keep your voltage on a decent amount, which is trial and error to find, you would never fry your system, and you're essentially capacitively coupled to your two-dimensional electron gas. So as Keith said, if you have a negative, you wouldn't start repairing, because electrons don't like negative voltage. If you have positive, you will start getting them. Okay, so essentially from those electrons, you will start creating some sort of electric field. So you will start repelling away the electrons underneath. Okay, and I don't know if the next one. No, okay, I haven't had. So, and then depending on the shape, and this is there's no real science around it. So, what you try to do is you try to trap a single electron in one hole. So you can create shape like this, for example. And by playing with the voltage, you start depleting the region completely under. And then you get to a point where you can actually really start seeing the electrons moving one by one. That would be my next slide. But you can see electrons moving one by one, moving out, all the way until you cannot see them move away from that part anymore. So then you know that you have zero electron left. And you can just bring back the last. Essentially, this is a laterally gated quantum dot. We just use lateral gates with voltage. Everything is electrical. Everything is capacitively coupled. And then we define an island here where we call few electron regime, but all the way down to the single electron regime. Now I'll go back and give you more detail of why it works. It all sounds all cool like this, but can we really make it work? Let's look at this guy here. So this is essentially a very, very classical model. Oh, let me just. I'm going to talk about how do we measure and what do we measure. Right now it's all fine. We can repel electrons, but we need to measure something. Okay? So there's different way of measuring, but the way we're looking at is we measure through ohmic contact. And ohmic contact is nothing more than something that behaves ohmic. What is an ohmic behavior? It's linear, right? And here you have a two-dimensional electron gas. So it's a conductor. It's absolutely linear. So essentially, we have ways we can use some material, and that material diffuse all the way through here and come touch the two-dimensional electron gas. So you can kind of see it as, I personally see it as drilling a hole and putting a little connection there. And then you can do another one, drill another hole here through a collection. And then if you connect a voltmeter to this or a voltage source, then you can monitor the current. Okay? So that's what we're going to do. Everything we're going to do is monitoring current and playing with it, and then we can get signature that I'm going to talk about. So, and then a lot of my cartoons, and ohmic contact looks like this. I put just a little X. Okay. So there's multiple ways. There's two ways, two easy ways you can sort of get information about what's going on in your dot. You can either look at the current through the dot, which I will call quantum transport, which I'm going to explain, or what you can do is you can look at the current in something close by, a very narrow slit close by, and I'll talk about it in a few minutes. This is called a quantum point contact. The quantum point contact is a very, very sensitive electrometer. It's so sensitive that if there's an electron more or less over there, it will change the conductance there, and you can essentially track in real time the number of electrons there. And I'm going to go back and forth between the two and show you how we can do things. Okay. Now, the whole structure of a quantum dot is fairly simple. Everything, so forget the whole quantum dot here. This is an electron sea. So what we call a Fermi sea. So it's a reservoir of electrons. You have an infinite amount of electrons, and they are all packed in the same state. So they fill all the continuous energy all the way to the Fermi level. And then here you get your dot, which will have something wonky. And here you have another Fermi sea. Okay, so regular conductor, something funny, regular conductor. Turns out we can really define a quantum dot using very classical notation. And this just represents what I was showing before. You have your source, which is, let's say, your first your first electron reservoir, your dot, and then your electron jump from your source to your dot. And now, because we made life hard to the electrons, right? We put negative voltage to the electrodes so they don't just go. They have to push through. So they will jump, and then they will jump to the drain. And then you can start measuring this. And that gate here, it's essentially a capacitor that you can compare. Whoops. And then you can compare it to a gate like this here that would just, by applying negative or positive, you can change the energy level of the dot because it's capacitively coupled. You put more positive, you give more energy to your dot, more negative, less energy to your dot. Okay? Now I'm really going in a very hand-wavy way. If you're already lost, please ask a question. Everything's clear enough? All right, so this is just how we designed it. Now, what we're going to do is you can somewhat imagine that if you have a channel of electron, and then you start putting some negative voltage on gates on top, you make life harder. So you kind of shape the potential landscape of what the electrons see. Okay, if we're just going to make one very easy. Let's say for now we don't have a two-dimensional electron gas, but we just have a one-dimensional. The electron can just go one way. And I put three prongs like this, which are attached to a certain voltage, V1, V2, V3. And let's say I put that one negative, that one positive, that one negative. What would the potential landscape look like? A hill? So, I mean, the current is going this way. Okay. Now here, I made his life hard because it's negative. It's an electron, right? So it means I'm increasing the potential. Here, I'm attracting it. And then over there, I'm making his life hard again. And you keep on going. Okay. Actually, normally, in real life, it's more like this one is very high. Then that one is not so low. That one's very high. What's going to happen is, like, the electron will come by, then they need to tunnel. This is sort of that thing here. And then here you have a nice little potential well. They can't get trapped there. It's not a potential well. It's actually a potential dot because it's a constriction in one dimension, so it's zero dimension. And then they can't go there again. Okay? That's essentially what a quantum dot is. You play with the electrons, the electrodes. You shave the potential. The potential landscape, and then you try to shape them, and try to trap the electrons. So there's a theory, not a theory, there's actually a theorem of quantum mechanics that says whenever you have a potential dip, I think there's a condition like as long as it's big enough or whatever, you have to have discrete states. Okay? An harmonic oscillator. We all worked it out. They all had discrete states. A particle in a box, it's all discrete state. And if you went a little further in your quantum mechanics classes, maybe you've seen the WJKB approximation, or maybe it's just called the WKB. It's just to show that essentially what it says is, like, everything in life is either a free particle or a harmonic oscillator to some approximation. So what I'm saying here is just that. At the end, we can really just look at our dot as being our Fermi scene. That's our potential well. And the other Fermi C. Okay? And because the potential well, it will start having discrete energy level. Okay? And then we can play with those energy level, as I was showing there. Like, if my positive electrodes, if I put more negative, I'm kind of pulling the well even lower. Or if I put more negative, I'm putting it up. So I can play with where the energy level are just by playing with one of the gates. All right, now let's close this. Let's do some real blackboard stuff. Wow. Can somebody open the light, please? Okay. So now what we're going to do, so again, so I say we have a certain Fermi level. So what it means is like what I have is electrons with any possible energy up to there. Okay. Then I have a certain tunnel barrier to go in the dot. That's my dot. And then I have my other energy level. Now remember I'm going to draw here what a dot can look like. So that's a double dot, actually. Okay. And then I had one like this here for fun. One like that. So now I'm going to look current from there to there. Okay. Here's a question for you. How can I adjust that Fermi level?
You just add more electrons.
No, the amount of electron is kind of given by the amount of doping you have.
Temperature.
Temperature. We're gonna talk about that soon. Temperature would just change. It would not make your Fermi level as sharp, but we're just gonna broaden it. Keith, you have something?
No.
All right. So what is the energy of an electron? If I plug it on, if I give 5 volts to an electron, what's the energy of the electron?
5
electron volts, right? So you multiply the volts by the charge of the electron, bang. We have direct access to this guy here, right? So we just put a nice voltage source, and then we can play with it. So I can connect a voltage source here. And, you know, in real life, we don't really need a voltage source. We just ground it. We just put it to zero. Who cares? Okay, but I'll keep it there. And then I say that this one I ground it to zero. Now we're getting a bit more into the technicality of the electronics. But what we're going to measure? We're going to measure the current going through there and there. So actually, before grounding it, we're going to add what we call an IV converter. It would just measure a current and make a voltage out of it. It's easier to measure voltage than current, but some people, that's electronic. The only thing I'm saying is we can measure the current, if it's large enough, of course. So now I'm gonna talk about something called zero bias. Zero bias quantum transport. This guy here, we call it V source. Actually, I should, to make sense with my notation. So let me go from V source, grounded, and here you're going to have an IV converter, and then grounded. And then you can also, if you want, you can also add a voltage source there and call it V drain, but we're just going to use V gradient to zero to make it easy. And the difference between the source and the drain, that's what we call bias. Okay? But for now, we're going to work at zero bias. It means that the Fermi level on the right side is equal to this Fermi level on the other side. Yes?
So is it appropriate to just think of it as the chemical potential?
I'm getting there. Yeah. But yeah, absolutely, you're right. So now I said there was a discrete energy level, okay? So what it means is, in order to fill a certain energy level, your electron has to have enough energy. Actually, it's a little bit more subtle than this. Your electron have to have enough energy to compensate the difference between your last filled energy level and the next one, okay? So what I'm saying is here, you have a whole bunch of states that contain 1, 2, 3, 4 million electrons. And with them, they all have an energy, or an equivalent of an energy of U of n, which is the energy to have an electron. Okay? Now, if the energy of every state, or sorry, the addition energy that I need to add an electron is always the same, then the energy here, the Fermi energy, is what you have available at the electron. So if I always need, let's say, 1 electron volt to add the next electron, then the electron will just keep on adding because there's nothing stopping them. There's always enough energy. Okay? So what you really want to look at is the difference energy. So what I'm saying is like what you really care is what we call the chemical potential of N, which is the difference in energy to get to add the nth electron given that they have N minus 1. Okay? So here what I'm drawing those chemical potential. Okay? Mu, let's say N minus 2, mu N minus 1, mu N, and so on. Okay? Now let's say we are in this situation here. Can somebody tell me what's going to happen? I've said yes, but I want the answer. You feel the nth electrons. But this I don't know. Experimentally, I'm measuring something. I'm measuring the current. So what am I measuring now? No, this is my system, okay? The way I've tuned my system and everything, it just happened that I'm in between two energy levels or two chemical potential levels. Keith?
What you'd end up measuring would be the current due to electrons tunneling through the dots.
Yes. But will I measure anything now? Huh?
What's now?
Like in this situation, if I connect, right? I mean, so I'm set in that situation, and I'm looking at the current going, at the electrons going from this side, which is the source, to that side, which is the drain. Is there an electron traveling? Why? Well, you said no. You have a 50% chance. So there's no, right now there's no voltage across. They are literally, those are at the same level, zero.
Because they're at the same level, right? Because they're at the same level, right?
No, something can still happen. What's good, like at the split second where I'm in that situation, what's gonna happen is before I had N minus one and I bring it lower, now all of a sudden I got N, which is lower the Fermi level. So an electron will come in and fill it. What then? Can it tunnel out? It doesn't have enough energy to tunnel out, right? Now, here you have an energy difference. You have to have enough energy to travel, but to go through. So here, actually what really happened is you have an electron at that energy traveling from the Fermi to there, but then this one only have the energy level to come here.
Can it not get randomly thermally excited?
Let's not talk about temperature for now, okay? Imagine zero temperature. So here, all those energy levels are filled. So there's no empty level. So the electron is literally trapped, cannot escape. Okay, yes?
Actually, just to make sure, we have to talk about zero temperature to be talking about like the Fermi energy in the ground
state. No, the Fermi energy is always defined. But the only difference, let's do a little aside of Fermi energy. At zero temperature, Fermi energy just means that if you look at, that's the occupancy, and that's the energy. So it just means that clock, it's straight down. It means at this, an energy level, so it's all occupied and then it's all empty. What temperature will do is just going to smear it. It's going to start looking like this. That's what temperature will do. I'll talk about that a bit later, very soon, what it's gonna do. But for now, let's just assume zero energy. I really just want you to understand the concept of when the electron can transport and when it won't. Okay? So in the situation we're in right now, the electron is gonna go in, but not out, because it doesn't have the energy to go over the hump. So that kind of answer the other question. Now, if I have all the energy level, and one of them is right on resonance, it can hop on, and hop off. Then you got a current. And it just flows and flows, and then you measure something on your oscilloscope or voltmeter or whatever. Okay? All this to bring is what we can verify with this is we're going to make a nice experiment. I'll keep that there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to plot current. Actually, we're going to measure voltage because it's an IV converter, but it doesn't matter. Current as a function of the voltage on, let's call this guy here, plunger. Just a name. Voltage on my plunger. Okay. We said the more positive my plunger is, the more positive, the more I attract electrons, so the more energy I give, I allow my dot. So more positive, I will be able to trap more and more electrons. So, essentially, I don't know where I start now. My dot might already have like 10 electrons, let's say, or it might have 1,000. But let's say we start at 1,000. Let's start at n. And then I go more and more negative. So what I'm saying is we start somewhere like we were before, in between two. Okay, so we have n here, n plus 1, n plus 2. As I put more and more energy on my gate, or more and more positive, essentially I'm taking my whole scale, the whole ladder, and I bring it down. Okay, I do that very slowly. So then I have zero current, because now it's the nth electron is in, but cannot get out. And then I hit the n plus 1, and at that point, current. For now, it's a delta function, right? Because it's really at this one place which is going to have current. It's not really delta function because you don't have an infinite current, but it's a very sharp peak. And then it keeps on going, and then you get another one. And then that way, you know that you have n, n plus 1, n plus 2, n plus 3. This is really what you measure.
Wait, so why do you have current on average at all? So wouldn't it be equally likely to go in one direction as the other if there's no bias?
Yes. Now we're getting at this. There's two reasons. One way is you only measure it when it goes one way. So you're right, it can go both ways, but we only have an IV converter there. True. And in the real life, we have temperature. Okay. And in real life, we put just a little bit of bias. For this reason, just to kind of help it force his way through there. Okay. Now let's talk. Let's talk about temperature a little bit. So what's temperature going to do? Instead of putting those corners very sharp, it's going to smear them a little bit, like this. So it means that if you have a state that show up. Let's say just a little higher, it will already start conducting. And then it's going to hit the Fermi level, and then a little lower, and it's going to conduct for a while because now it's more smeared, right? So instead of having a very sharp peak, you will start seeing, because of temperature, you're going to start seeing finite width. Okay? So that's quantum transport at zero bias. And just so you know, this we normally do it at roughly on the picoamp, pico to femtoamp. So it's very, very little current. So very good low noise electronic. Okay, now I'm gonna challenge you to the next question, so that we'll see if you are actually following. So, finite bias quantum transport. Okay, so I want you to trace me. So I'm going to do the same thing. Voltage on plunger, current, And here I have a finite bias. Okay, let's call it, new SD, source drain, different of energy. What is the graph going to look like? You say what?
So it's going to be more or less the same, but there's going to be a trend for it to be increasing in between because the electrons are getting more energy.
Okay, so maybe I'll clarify one thing first. Maybe you'll change your thought. I will assume that the source drain bias, it's smaller than, let's say, the difference between one chemical potential and the other chemical potential. So what I'm saying is there's always going to be one allowed state in the bias at the time. Okay, we'll make it because then if you had more allowed, that would be absolutely right. Yes?
The fluxes just get finite width.
Exactly. So what's going to happen is when your energy level comes here, then you can tunnel. But if it's there, or if it's there, or if it's there, it can keep on tunneling. So the only difference is now, instead of having a sharp peak, you're going to start getting something like that. Okay? All right, let's push that a little bit. Now, what we're going to do is going to do a three-dimensional plot. Okay? So we'll look like this. Here I'm going to plot the source drain, and here the voltage on the plunger. So I do one experiment, I record one trace, and another experiment, record another trace, and I'm wondering how's that going to look like. Can somebody? So we can always, okay, let's go by inference. Let's guess. So here's when we had a source drain of zero, of nothing, of zero. So what was our graph looking like? Delta phi, very sharp peak. So it's going to look, essentially, it's going to look like if we look at the third dimension, it's going to look like little dot at that point here. Now, we were at finest bias. What was it looking like? So it was like fatter, right? So essentially it was looking, so you had, if we look in the third dimension, so it was fatter, but how fat was it? How wide can it be? Right, it's this width, right? And it's this width before and after in some sense. So it's gonna be sort of, just to align, already this. Well, I'm kind of missing the point here. And so on and so forth. So if I go to higher bias, I get to larger peak, smaller bias, smaller peak. So essentially what we're seeing is we're creating some sort of diamond like this. I'm not going to start the projector, but I'm just going to show you an example on my computer. Well, I guess I didn't put it there. All right, it's not there. But it's literally going to, you're going to look at, so you're going to have big areas with no current. And then you can also look at the other, at the negative bias, so you will get like, we're calling the diamond. Why do we care about this? Yes? So, now, if I ask you the question, what is the energy between the different levels? I want you to give me a number in electron volts, in energy. What is the energy between, let's say, my U equal N
and then I want the M plus one.
Okay, so we know that here it's N, here N plus one, N plus two. Okay, what is the axis here?
And voltage.
Voltage on the plunger.
Do we just adjust our plunger until our current is continuous?
So what are you applying to the plunger? Voltages, right? And the plunger changed the energy of the state through capacitance coupling. What's the capacitance? If you want to transfer a voltage on a capacitor to an actual energy, you need to know what the capacitance is. What's the capacitance?
You measure it by putting different frequencies there.
Could be one way, but it's not very precise. This is why we care about this. This will give us the answer. Okay? And what it will give us, essentially you can look at the source drain, and here, at this point here, you know exactly what was the energy level. Because the source drain, the voltage applied to there, gives you the exact energy of the electron. So essentially by looking at the distance, or you can come here, you can looking at the distance between this point and that point in voltage, transform into energies. So you can show the linear correlation between the voltage on your plunger to the energy of electrons. That's why we care. It's when you really want, like, doing all those is nice, but you really want to bring it back to actual physical meaning of energy levels and orbital splitting and all that kind of stuff. Okay? This is quantum transport in single dot. Oh, no, we don't have plenty of time. Okay.
So why do we care about that?
Because when you want to know what your science, when you want to know what your system is, you want to know the Hamiltonian. And at some point, if you want to work with the Hamiltonian, you cannot work with things you don't know. You want to know you need to know what is the energy level between your certain dot to make sure that your temperature is not too high, or to make sure that you need to characterize. That's one example. Okay? So we haven't done much quantum computing so far, but I wanted to go through this to make you understand roughly how quantum dots work, how the energy level work, how they get filled, how they get unfilled. Is there any question on this so far? Yes, Marianne.
Okay, so just to clarify, when you measure the distance between those two points that you've marked up there, that gives you the difference in energy levels?
Yeah, so
the absolute energy scale?
No, not absolute. Nothing is absolute in energy, right? So it gives you, so essentially what it says is, like, at this point, let's say this is, 1 milli electron volt, okay, which is pretty big. So it means to cover a whole 1 milli electron volt, I had to go from this voltage to that voltage. So that gives you the factor that transfer voltage to the energy. But in terms of, there's no absolute scale of energy. You can always say this is my, because you always compare energy with each other, right? So you have a constant on one end, on the other end. So that's why here I was not putting any voltage on my drain. I can just ground it. Okay. Sometimes we put voltage, but that's for other reason. Any question so far? All right. So now I said I will be talking about two different ways of measuring. Let me go through the other way quickly. So with that one, actually, you can really start getting information about the energy level, and then how your dot looked like, and then you can infer the shape. But in quantum computing, normally when you know what your dot looks like, you don't care too much. What you really care is how many electrons you have in there. Oh, and by the way, what I didn't mention is you can actually do that diamond thing. And then you lower the energy and lower and lower. And at some point, the diamond won't do any diamond anymore. We'll just keep on expanding. That's when there's no more electron to release. Right? Essentially, you push your ladder up. And at some point, there's no more electron that can go through because there's no more energy level possible. So that's at that point, you know you're at the zero electron. Then you can just bring it back to the single electron. So now the other way to measure is instead of going looking at the current through the dot, we'll look at the current through that little part here that we call a QPC, so or quantum point contact. It's going to look exact. So it's going to look roughly the same. So we're just going to put another ohmic contact there with a voltage source. And then we look at the current going through this. Now, experimentally, it's unfortunate. I really want this year to create an experiment that you will have done this, doing a quantum point contact on 4 Kelvin, but didn't have time, unfortunately. Maybe next year. So we're going to look at what's happening. So I'm going to keep that voltage there fixed. Okay, just at some voltage. I'm not touching it. I'm going to sweep this voltage on this guy, okay, toward more and more negative. So essentially, if you have two gates and you put that one more and more negative, you're creating more and more of a restriction. It's going to get harder and harder to go through. Make sense? Right? So if you look at voltage, I'm going to call that one VVQ, voltage on Q. So if there's very little negative voltage, you can have a lot of current. Anyway, yeah, this is current. Okay. So as you start decreasing the voltage here, so it's not going to be ohmic because everything is capacitive coupled. So it's going to some weird stuff's going to start happening. But you know, you're going to see the current going down. And at some point, what's going to happen is you're going to start seeing step. This was actually a very cool experiment that I think was in the 80s or early 90s. This shows that current is quantized also. And the theory that explained what it means is that when you have those super small current like this is actually a wave. You can approximate it by a waveguide. It just means that current traveled through channels. And the more you restrict this, the less channels are open. And that's sort of what you start counting here. So I hear, well, maybe I have, I got 3 channels open. Now I close one channel, so I lost. Then close another one channel. And there's actually a quanta of conductance in some sense. Yes, Monica?
What do you mean by channel there?
It's literally, you know, when we say channel, it just means that the current can only go through discrete modes. Just like photon in a fiber. There's discrete modes. You can think of it a little bit like that. And the more you restrict, the more modes you're closing. So what I want you to understand from this is because of the electrical environment, here I'm putting more negative voltage, I can change the conductance. Right? So if I sit here, right now there's some current. If I change the voltage of my gate just a little bit, I move it here. There's a huge difference of current because the slope is very steep. So a little bit of change in the voltage of my gates will make a huge difference in the resistance, which is good, right? You want to be very sensitive, but you want to have something that you can measure. So you want a big change for a little bit of change. So now here I talk about gates, but you can imagine an electron trapped in there creates an electric field. So it does create an electric environment. So if you add an electron or you lose an electron, there's going to be a change in the magnetic field. So there's going to be a change of what's going on here. And then that will change the resistance. All of it makes sense? And it does. It does happen that way. You can see, roughly speaking, if my memory is good, so you monitor the current through there, and the current is about, let's say, 1 nanoamp. And the change can be about 5 picoamps. So we can have a change of 5%. Well, let's say from 1 to 5%, depending on the geometry of everything. But if your electronic is good enough, or your electrical engineering is very good and low noise, you can detect this. And if I have time, I'll show you some actual real data. Like literally looks, the noise looks like this, and then you can see a step like that. So it's that clear. Like, and when that step here, actually I see a step, but It's more like that. So here you had, n electron, and here you add n minus one electron. Or if you have, you can flip them. But every time there's an electron leaving, you see a step in your QPC. So essentially, that gives you a way to monitor how much electron you have in here, but without really never invading it, just by monitoring here. If you want to go into details, yes, you do mess up with it a little bit because it's a weak measurement and there's some back action. But for what the purpose of what we want to do now, it's perfectly good. It's an electrometer. Okay. So I define the quantum dot. I define how we can read it. How do we make a qubit? I can think of two possible ways, at least. Logan.
Well, just have two energy levels.
That's one way.
I think you should have had a diagram of two quantum dots linked close by to each other, so presumably their electric fields interact.
That could be another one. You can have, my first slide, there was one of them that had two dots. So you can think of having an electron in one or an electron in the other one. Okay, that's another way. Very good. There's a third way. There's something I haven't talked about yet that all electrons have. Come on, we've been working with this all week. The spin. Okay, so we can use a spin or we can use a charge. The problem with charge is they relax very quickly. What I mean by this is it is possible to be in a superposition of one and two electron, but it doesn't live very long. It dies. The too much Coulomb interaction, it doesn't stay. Same thing with having a charge in two dots. And experiment's been done. It was very nice results, but it doesn't live too long. Coherence of nanosecond. Okay? So the spin is great. I mean, spin is natural. Is the natural candidate. It's fairly resilient to the noise. So we're going to do that. So what do I need if I want to have a spin qubit?
Magnetic field.
Right? So we're just going to do the same thing, and we're going to toss in the magnetic field. Now here's a little fun thing, though. There's three possible ways you can put a magnetic field. So we had our pancake now. We can put it this way, or that way. You guys ever heard of the quantum Hall effect?
Right.
So we have electrons moving around. If you put an electric field that way, right? Charge with velocity, magnetic field, torque. They start turning around. In the type of magnetic field we work in, we could deal with it. It's fine. But we're just going to put it in the plane so that you don't create what we call edge state and all this. We have less to worry about. So we put a magnetic field in the plane, we split the energy level, and we're back to NMR in some sense. Okay? So I could go along the way of how to control it, but you guys are now expert in magnetic resonance, so we can control it in magnetic resonance. We can just put a little coil or a little magnet there and apply some radio frequency, and you can control it. So that's not the interesting part. The interesting part would be how to measure it. Okay? But two things I would mention, though. Electrons have a gyromagnetic ratio of about, is it 1,000 or 2,000 times greater than the nuclei? So what it means is, if I have, let's say, my hydrogen nuclei at 200 megahertz, my electron precession frequency would be at 66 gigahertz. Try to design a coil at 66 gigahertz. It's a pain. So it's very hard. So what I'm saying is, yes, magnetic resonance is a good way. Well, it's a way. It's not a good way. But that's probably going to talk more about that the second half of my lecture. But now, I'm not going to concentrate on controlling, because we know how to control spin. It can be applied. I'm going to concentrate on how to measure. In NMR, we were measuring, we had to put a whole whack load of nuclei spin together so that we have enough signal. Here, we're working with truly a single quantum dot, single electron. So we're going to try to measure a single electron spin. Anybody heard about a single spin magnetometer? Doesn't exist. Whoever can come up with it, it's Nobel Prize right away. so get working. But essentially, we cannot directly detect a single spin. So we're going to have to be a bit more clever. Okay? But what I showed you with the QPC is I said we can detect a single electron moving out of a dot or moving in. So if we are able to find a way to essentially map a spin to a charge or do a spin-to-charge conversion, we're golden. And that's what we're going to do. So now what I'm going to say, you have to take my word for it, but the energy difference between two occupation states, so the energy difference between having one electron versus having two electrons, is much greater than any other energy level within the one electron. Okay? So when you have one electron, or two electrons, or three electrons, there's many different types of energies you can have. Zeeman splitting. Okay? But now we only talked about the how many electrons. But when you have a wave function, you have to think about everything. So how many electrons, that's one part of the wave function. The spin is another part. Can you guys think of another part? Wave function has a spin, has a number of charge. There's something else, you need to describe it. And that's probably something most of the that you probably dealt for most of your quantum mechanics class. Wave packet. It has a shape. Right? You need to describe not where it is, but its probability. Essentially, you have to describe how it looks like. Where's the wave function of finding it? Okay? So now what that means is, in a quantum dot, you have a spin, you have a wave function. And turns out that the wave function has the exact same properties than the wave function of an electron in the hydrogen. So it has orbitals, an s orbital, a p orbital, a d orbital. A quantum dot, that's the beauty of it, it's actually an artificial atom. It has all the same characteristics of an atom, but you build it with your hands, well, with a machine. Okay? So now what I'm getting at is, what I was saying is, when you take into account all the energy splitting in your thing, you, if I say that I'm at the one electron level, and then you work within that region, if you don't pulse like ridiculously big, so the next electron available, we need much more energy, then you will actually need to play with either the excited states, the orbital states, or the spin states. So what I'm saying with all this, this big detour, is now let's just concentrate on spin, no, electron equal one. One electron, and we'll work from that. Okay, so now we're going to concentrate on all the other. So right now, I don't really care about the other side of the Fermi level, because I'm just looking, like I'm looking at the QPC right now. Right, if you remember what it looks like. Like this, like that, here, blah. So essentially what I'm going to do, I'm just going to assume that this here is closed, so the electrons don't really move there. They're just going to move here and there, and that's what we look at. Okay? Just for simplicity. And then we can totally control that in the lab. We can find, we can shut that down, and we can open that one. So essentially you have your dot that looks like that. And then you're at the one electron regime. You apply a magnetic field, so you split your spin up and spin down. This is your spin up. This is your spin down. Let's say for now, for whatever, so let's bring, I'm giving you half the answer. Okay, so up or down. And then the n equal 2 is like way up in the ceiling, so I don't have to worry about a second electron. Now I say, I will tell you, okay, I'm filling this dot with an absolutely random electron. Can you spin up or can you spin down? Can you guys see a certain protocol that I could do that what I'm going to measure depending on an electron being spin up would be different than whether the electron is spin down?
You just have to make sure that your Fermi energy would fall exactly between the spin up level and the spin down level, so that if it's spin, say, up, it won't get through, and if it's spin down, it will get through.
Did everybody get that? Make sense? So if you bring this guy here, so we have a spin up and spin down. So now let's analyze what the QPC is going to look like. Okay, so normally at this point, if I have an electron, let's just say if I have my current versus, this is versus time. I'm going to look in real time. This is my level of n equal 1 electron, and this is my level of n equals 0 electron. Okay? So if my dot is loaded with a spin up, what is the trace of the QPC going to look like on the oscilloscope? If it's an up, so I have an electron here, what's going to happen? Huh? Nothing. Nothing, right? It's stuck there, doesn't have energy to go. So what are you going to measure? This is just a noise. Okay, so that's, and then you conclude, spin up. Now if I have a spin down, what's going to happen? So it start, so this is, sorry. You guys should have corrected me on that one. Always have one. So and if I start with a spin down, what's going to happen as a function of time? Well, you tell me, time is passing by. It goes to go n equals 0. And then? Then that's it? Well, no. So if it wasn't spin down, it went out. No, that's empty. Sorry? Another one will come and fill it here. And that will create a pulse. And that you can detect. It's not as easily detected as it's done. Because let's start talking in real physics and real engineering here. There's a few things I need to ensure to be able to see that pulse. Any electrical engineers in the room? Yes. There you go. Then you should know the answer. All right. Let me help you out. What if my tunneling rate is in, let's say it can tunnel in and out in 0.00001 nanofemtosecond. Has to be faster. Okay. Well, unfortunately, sometimes you cannot make your sampling rate faster. Okay. Sometimes your electronic is just stuck at a certain bandwidth. So you need to work with what you have. And what we have is we can control the tunneling rate. Like that tunnel rate here, how fast the electron goes in and out, we can literally control it quite precisely. I wouldn't say to the hertz, but obviously to the kilohertz. Okay? And typically, electronics, at least the one we use these days and that we know works well, are in about the 15, 20 kilohertz, 40 kilohertz bandwidth range. So it means that this guy here has to be less than 8 microseconds. So no, that we can do, but you have to ensure that it's done. And you have, of course, to make sure that your signal-to-noise ratio is big enough. Okay? So this is how you can detect a single spin in quantum dot. And if you guys want to know sort of how you would go to do a true experiment of this. So here's another thing. How do I load a completely random, first question, how do I load a completely random spin in my dot? No, it's already on. Magnetic field already on. And you cannot turn on and off a magnetic field. It takes an hour and a half. to get to several Tesla, it takes a while. Yeah.
I suppose one way to be to basically thrust the plunger down faster than than this jumping process can happen.
What jumping process?
The whole electron jumping out of the higher level and going into the lower level.
Sure, but like you have no idea what you start with.
Sorry, you asked.
I want you to find a way to put an electron with a completely random spin in it. Okay, let's say I...
If just both your levels were below, then like yeah. whichever one happened to go in there, you don't know. They're both legitimate.
Okay, and what do I do to make sure that there was not an electron? Like, now I'm starting to ask stupid questions. But yeah, you start with an empty dot, pulse it down, then something random going to go in, and then measure it, right? So now, what are you... So, okay, then I'm gonna challenge you on that one. Essentially, I'm asking you to come up with the experiment they did in 2004 for Sunday. How will you prove to me that what you measure is actually the spin? How will you prove to me that those square that you see or those poles that you see are not just your electronic going bazook every now and then?
What if you see what happens if you apply a pulse to it through a flip bulb?
Now, let's say we don't have pulse right now.
Okay.
If you don't see that pulse, both the levels are way below. But isn't it proving that it's all because of the spins?
Sorry, say that again?
Both potentials are way below, so you just can't know the spins are affecting at all. And if you don't see the same pulse, then isn't that pretty much concluding that it's from...
Here's a little something. Let's say that your electron temperature is very high, okay? Because going to a dilution fridge at 30 millikelvin does not mean that your electrons are 30 millikelvin, because all your electronics come from room temperature. There's a lot of crap coming from room temperature going down there, and one of them is called the Johnson noise, which is a noise that you cannot get rid of. It's due to temperature, and it scales like square root of the temperature, so you go from... You know, you essentially go from 300 Kelvin to 30 millikelvin, so you have 1,000. So if you need to find ways to minimize that, so you can minimize the noise, but you cannot get rid of it. But what I'm saying, let's say you suck at electronics, okay? And you have a lot of noise down there. And your electrons are very, very, very hot. So what's going to happen is your Fermi level now is going to be very broad. But you only have so much electric field that you can apply. So whether you're up or down, it can go back and forth and back and forth. Okay? So that would be an example where just saying, and first of all, the only thing you really have access to is your current. You don't have access to where my energy level is. The only thing you can infer, the only thing you're measuring is current. You have to deduce everything from your current. Okay? So what I'm saying is like, yes, at some point, even if it's super broad, at some point you will know pretty much for sure that you're below the Fermi level. So you will know pretty much for sure that you have a random spin. Now my question is, when you bring it to the measurement, how can you prove that when you conclude that it's a spin up, it was actually a spin up, and when you conclude that it was a spin down, it was actually a spin down? You need to come up with a proof to this to make sure that you're not just being lucky.
Well, if you do it a whole bunch of times, then you can map the energy difference between if you always go back to the same point,
yeah,
and then it randomly gets filled, and then you raise the energy until you see the current flow again. So then that would be a certain delta E.
Sure.
And then if you... So you kind of have like two choices. Sometimes it'll be filled with a different spin, so you have a different delta E, and you can do that a lot.
But you don't control which one it gets filled with.
No, but you'll see that it's either one or the other if you do this a whole bunch of times.
Yes, but...
And then you'll have a discrete energy difference, which you can look at, okay, well, that's the difference in energy of a spin of an electron in this magnetic field, which we know we've applied.
Yeah, but now you're not answering my question. Now what you're answering... is you're finding, and by the way, it's a known technique. Now you're finding out the Zeeman splitting. Okay, and it's a lock-in technique. Maybe if we have time, we'll talk about it. But now the only thing you're saying is like the difference between spin up and spin down is this much. That's not what I'm looking at. What I'm looking at is if I give you a spin, I want you to tell me, is it up or is it down? So we devise something that in principle work. But of course, things in the lab are never perfect. There's temperature broadening. There's also other stuff that can happen. So if I say that If I tell you that the injection ring, so half the time it's spin up, half the time it's spin down. And then you fill it, read it, how many spin up, how many spin down can you get? Should you get? Half and half, right? Is that enough to conclude anything? You can be, that can still be a completely random process. How can I ensure that from the half and half, I get a changing distribution of spin up and spin down? Okay? I'm giving you a half a spin up or sorry, a spin up or a spin down with a half and half probability. What can you do? You don't know the spin, but what can you do so that what you will measure will have more chance to be up than being down? We've worked on, that's what we did in NMR. That was one of the experiments of NMR.
You said we're not allowed to use a pulse.
You're not allowed to do a pulse.
Not like you're not allowed to do a Rabi oscillation pulse. And even then that would not help you because you don't know what spin you have.
Can't change the magnetic field.
No, magnetic field cannot be changed. Come on, that was experiment number, that was the first fun experiment in NMR. What were we doing? What were we measuring? What did we do in NMR? Hamiltonian? We did the, finding the J coupling. And then the first experiment, we did a 180 degree pulse and then waited and then measure something. What were we doing?
The relaxation time.
Relaxation. Okay? The ground state in there is a spin up. So if it inject with both spin, like with a probability of spin up and spin down, the more you wait, the more it's going to relax. So if you inject, then wait, then measure, you should have more than a 50-50 probability of measuring spin up. And this is how you prove that you're measuring spin and not some noise. So you do that experiment over and over again. You eject, wait there, and then measure. So then you do that statistically a lot. And then you empty, eject, wait longer, then measure. Do that a bunch of time, and you keep on going. And what you're supposed to see is the probability of measuring a spin up as a function of waiting time. Should be an exponential. And that exponential, minus T over T1. This is one of the key things in experimental physics. Coming up with a protocol and then showing that your protocol works, that's no good. You have to prove beyond doubt that it works. Okay? Just because I'll take you just for an example. Actually, it turns out that experimentally, and we don't know why, the injection rate is about 75% up and 25% down. We don't understand why. But see, if we would just have, waited, measure, and we've got 25% down, we're like, whoa, something would be wrong. But then we change the measurement time, then you can see that the probability, that's wrong. I should have picked up on that. Measuring a pin up, and then the probability of measuring spin up goes on like this, like 1 minus e alpha e. So, yeah, so in real life, normally you're expecting this to come to 50%. This should go actually to 1, so forth. Actually, no, to 1. Anyway, but in real life, you don't get 50-50. But you don't care. Like, that's not what you're after. You were not after looking at the injection rate. You were after making sure that you measure a spin up or a spin down. And thanks to relaxation, the more you wait, the less spin down you have, and that's how you prove that you're actually measuring a spin up and a spin down. Does it make sense? Well, I guess it's dinner time. I pretty much went to where I wanted to go. So next week, there's a whole tons of things we can do with that. But not next week, but I think I'm speaking again on Thursday. And I will be talking about double dots. Because then double dots, maybe before finishing. So I said we need to have In real life, temperature is not zero, it's broadened. So we can achieve with about 100 millikelvin for the electron temperature. So what is the condition on our Zeeman splitting? Well, actually, I'm not going to ask a question. But you want to make sure that your Zeeman splitting is at least bigger than the splitting of your Fermi function, right? So you know you want it to be sort. You will always have some errors because of this, because the Fermi level. You're always going to have a spin down that might tunnel out. And of course, the bigger, the more the spread, the bigger the spread, the less possibility, the less possible it is. So typically, with what to get something fairly good, you look at 6.5 Tesla. Okay, and if my memory is good, at 6.5 Tesla, the resonance frequency of the electron. So if you want to control it using Larmor frequency, it's above 40 gigahertz. It's around 30 something gigahertz. And that's from an engineering point of view. Not so nice. Not impossible. Actually, they're working on this. My former group is working on this, but it's very hard.